darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I say? Here I am, Lord. Is it our Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you
is your day. You have made it. May we celebrate in your wonder and the gift of life itself. Use this life and all that we offer to your glory. Amen. Before we are seated, let's say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in the heavens, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so upon the earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Please be seated. I'd like to add another reading in this morning with what we've got already. There's a few readings, but we'll move quickly through it. Isaiah 40, 28 to 31. Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, faints not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. He gives power to the faint, and to them that have no might he increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. It has to be one of my favorite Bible verses. Problem is that there are so many Bible verses that I like, but it's one of my favorite. And in terms of what we're looking at today, spiritual independence. Notice here the Lord's words, the wind blows where it wills, and you hear the sound thereof, but cannot tell where it comes and where it goes. So is every one that is born of the Spirit. I don't know about you, but in my own times of reading the Bible, that's one of those verses that you come to and you go, what does the Lord mean? Those who are born of the Spirit are like the wind. And then the longer you've been walking with the Lord, the more you start to realize that there's this paradox. There's this paradox between surrendering to God and becoming the very best version of yourself that the Lord wants. And one of the reasons it's a paradox is because of the way the world views surrender. The idea of surrender. You have two armies battling, and if one surrenders, they've lost the war. The worldly idea of surrendering is not really a positive one, is it? Because you're the loser and somebody else is the victor. But it's actually completely the other way around in the things of God. Surrendering to God is not loss, it's gain. And that's what we're going to look at today with spiritual independence. On the surface, you could think, how could spiritual independence be a virtue? You know, in churches, we're always told, you know, be dependent upon God. Yield, give in, lay down your life. And all of that's true. But it's what comes out of truly laying down your life, this spiritual independence that we're focusing on, the virtue of becoming just who the Lord intended you to become. So before we move to the order of service, I'm just going to run us through quickly some passages where Swedenborg has written in his own spiritual experiences about this subject. And you're going to find some amazing things in here. And then we'll move to the actual order. We cannot have creation without separation. Think about that. Or at least the appearance. You know, it's an appearance. Because the ungodly says, well, there is no God. But if the Lord were to withdraw from that ungodly person for but a second, their heart would stop beating, their lungs would stop breathing, they'd cease to be. But the appearance is that I am alive in and of myself. I'm an independent person. And we are. That's exactly how the Lord made us. But when we understand that it's His life at work in us and we surrender to that, this is where we're going to discover some amazing spiritual benefits for us. An endless number of things can be said about self-rule.
the ego or the proprium in the individual, specifically about its nature in a body-orientated or worldly person, in a spiritual person, and in a heavenly person. So the natural person that doesn't even know they've got a spirit, the spiritual person who's working on themselves, and the heavenly, the person who's become into the very image and likeness of God. That's what he's talking about there, those three different levels. In a carnal materialistic people, their sense of autonomy is the all in all. They know nothing else. If it died, they would think they had died, as noted earlier. Think of how many people are so attached to their ego. You bruise their ego, you bruise their very life. Isn't that interesting? But we know how valuable it is to get separated from that in Christ, to be separate from our ego, and to know that. Swedenborg goes on to say here, a little bit later on, autonomy looks the same in a spiritual person or people. Although they know and admit the Lord is the life in all things, that he is the giver of wisdom and understanding, and so of thought and action, they do not really believe it. Now, this is kind of where we start our spiritual walk with God. We're told that, you know, the Lord is responsible for everything in our life. And we're thinking, oh, well, I believe that, you know. But we're saying with our lips, we haven't yet really begun to experience the very life of God at work in us. Heavenly people, though, however, acknowledge that the Lord is the life of all and the giver of thought and action because they perceive that it is so. And they have no desire at all for autonomy. Yet even though they do not seek autonomy, the Lord gives it to them. This autonomy or selfhood is directly bound up with their ability to perceive what is good and true and with their happiness. Now I know in my own walk with the Lord, there are times where I'm sure you've all been here, where it's like, oh Lord, I don't want to do this. Please take over. I seem to do things and I mess it up. I make it worse. You know, I think I'm hearing from God and, oh, that didn't work out how I expected. Please, Lord, help me. Take over. Has anyone else been there? You've been in that place where you want the Lord to take over? And here's this paradox. He does and he will, but in such a gentle way, because we still need to act. This is something that for 2,000 years, Christianity has kind of struggled with, this idea of laying down the life but still having a responsibility to act. We still have a responsibility to shun evil. We have to. If we don't shun evil, it's going to take over. Even though you can be very prayerful in saying, don't let it take over my life, Lord. If you're not actively doing that, you're not creating room for his power to come in. And the interesting thing is that when you do get victory over a sin, how do you feel? Did you feel God just took over and it all happened? Or did you feel that you really had to put effort in? You had to put effort in, didn't it? Yeah. And so this is this spiritual state where we believe, but we don't really believe. But when we become the seventh day man, or the heavenly man, the day where we can rest in God, all of that's still true, but we still perceive that life of God in us. We perceive it. We now feel and know that that strength in life is actually coming from the Lord. So this brings us back to our point, which was that without creation being the way it is, where you have to feel as though you are separate from God, but you're not, there could be no you and there could be no me. There could be no family of God. Such is the autonomy of selfhood present in angels, and its presence brings them the highest peace and tranquility. Right? So this kind of selfhood that angels have, that we want to be like, it's where they trust and know the Lord is doing everything. And they want to be led by the Lord continuously, don't they? Just like we do. We want to be led by the Lord continuously. In fact, angels don't want any ego at all. They would rather not have it, but the Lord still gives it to them. He goes on to say, their selfhood is composed of qualities that belong to the Lord, who governs their self-governance, or rather governs them through their self-governance. This selfhood is the epitome of heavenliness. The selfhood of a bodily-centered person, on the other hand, is hellish. So how is it that we can become like the Lord and like the angels? How is it that we can have an ego, but it's not hellish? Well, the more that the Lord is regenerating us, the more we're laying down our life and taking up the cross inside of us, and we're dying to that side of us, the more this heavenly self comes up, this heavenly ego, as Swedenborg calls it. And it still has a sense of self. I exist. I'm important. But what happens is you become more important to me than my own sense of self. Does that make sense? I'm caring more about you. I mean, I'm still important. I don't want to be hungry and naked and poor, but I'm actually caring about you. You're my focus. Now, if you try and create a creation where we don't have egos, imagine God's problem. It had to be this way. He had to create a world where he could give life to individual souls who are intrinsically connected to him, and yet they feel separate. How else can you live your own life? It's amazing, isn't it? And thus, the gift of heaven is free. But if people want to go to hell, that's also their choice as well. You know, the Lord is doing everything he can to make sure we don't go there. But it's a choice. It's that free choice. Amazing. You know, with the greatest gifts come the greatest responsibility, isn't it? Or is that a Spider-Man quote? I don't know. But it's true, isn't it? Like, the more valuable the gift that you're given, the greater the responsibility you're given with it. And there really is no greater gift than selfhood. Isn't it? Think about it. He's given you your own life. But we're going to get into this idea of surrendering that life back to the Lord and what that looks like. I'll finish these quotes first, and then I'll go back to they that wait upon the Lord. The appearance of separateness also protects us from profanation. Because we really don't know what a profanation means, that we're taking what's holy and not treating it's holy. So Daniel was in Babylon, and they brought in all these beautiful treasures from the temple and began to drink. The king began to drink out of them, and then that night the kingdom fell because they took what was holy and profaned it. Now the reality is we're all doing that at times. We're all taking what's holy and not treating it with the kind of reverence that we should. But part of protecting us from real deep profanation is this appearance of separateness. The Lord gives us an appearance of being separate. The Lord who provides and foresees all things conceals the operation of his providence, and to such a degree that we scarcely know whether there is any providence at all. He permits us rather to attribute ordinary events to prudence and to good fortune, and even ascribe many things to nature, rather than that through any striking manifest signs of the divine providence and presence, we should plunge unreasonably into the midst of holy things in which we would not remain. Okay, so I'll explain that a bit more if we go to the next. There are so many treasures in the Bible. Hidden deep. That's that spiritual sense of the word. And we're not getting to them yet, are we? Because we wouldn't treat them with the proper respect that they deserve. So the time comes where we are ready for that, and the Lord reveals them to us. Your quiet reading time, you're reading something, and it's like, whoa, that just hit me. Why have I never seen that before? Look at this. And he's like, yeah. No, look at that. Yeah. They're not getting it the way you're getting it. Because at that moment, you're ready for the Lord to reveal the holiness of what's written there. And you won't profane it. You'll hold it as holy and keep it as holy. So the rest is still kind of veiled and a bit mysterious and hidden from us until we're ready to be brought into it and keep it. Does that make sense? That's kind of what he's saying there. Okay, and this is a part of the separateness, our ego and our separateness. He goes on to say, the Lord also permits similar things in accordance with other laws of his providence, namely that we should enjoy freedom. Ah, freedom. Boy, oh boy, oh boy. I want to shout this to the world. I want to shout it to the governments of the world. Do not violate our freedom. Do not do that. It is sacred. It is so sacred, God has hidden himself from us. That's the point that we're making today, isn't it? I mean, Paul says in Romans,
Don't be foolish. Look around you. You'll see the fingerprint of God in all of creation. But he's still hiding himself from us. You know, you can't emphatically prove to someone that he's real, can you? But you know it in here.
Yeah.
Right. See, he's hiding himself from us for that very reason, to keep us in freedom. That's how important freedom is. And it's also why the hells love to attack our freedom. In any way they can, they want to control. Control, control, control. Hell is all about control. Heaven is all about freedom. Isn't that beautiful? Okay. And this is why the more we surrender to God, the more we are going to get what? Freedom. It's a paradox, isn't it? Because the world would say, surrender? That sounds like a different level of control to me. Surrender to a higher being? No, thank you. I didn't finish that quote, did I? Namely, that we should enjoy freedom and that in all that we do, we should act according to reason. So this idea of acting according to reason means I'm doing it because it's reasonable and it's right, not because God says do it. I'm not saying that God doesn't say do it, but it's got to be my choice. Does that make sense? That's what makes it righteous, is that we are choosing to do it. Otherwise, we'd be robots. Each one of us would just be robots, and the Lord would sort of create us like characters in a book. And you just say and you just do whatever the character is told to do. But he says that we should enjoy freedom and that we should act according to reason, thus entirely as if from ourself. For it is better that we should ascribe the operations of divine providence to our own prudence and our own good fortune, than we should acknowledge that and still live like a devil. Wow. You know, and I've seen this so many times in more fundamental versions of Christianity, where it's so literal that they take scripture so literal on some levels that, oh, you know, thank you God, I'm forgiven for my sins, but then they're living like a devil. That's not right. It shouldn't be that way. Okay, but the reality is it is that way, because if we don't have freedom, then we don't have anything. We have nothing. It's all, you know, God is freedom. And my last point before we move into the order of service, there can be no salvation or eternal life without spiritual independence or true individual freedom. Now that should be making sense now. You know, it's got to be your choice. You've got to choose. I love the way the Lord says, I place before you life and death. And then he says, subtext, choose life, please. Choose life. It's like it's a choice. Here is life, here is death. My option, choose life. But it's up to you, isn't it?
Remember those shirts in the 80s, choose life?
I don't remember that one.
Massive writing, a big trend about 1985.
I wonder if it was inspired by scripture.
And it was all bright colours. Yeah, you've got to wonder. Yeah.
Choose life. Yeah. Wow, that's...
Go-Go too, I think, was another one. But yes. Remember, choose life, don't you?
Yes. If we're going to talk about quotes, I'm not a fan of Nike by any means. Believe me, the things they do. And anyway, but the motto, just do it. If only the Lord could encourage more believers to just do it. But it's free will. It's free choice. You know, the Lord can tell a devil, go. And what does that devil do? Does it argue? If it does, it doesn't last very long in the argument, does it? It goes. The Lord tells us, go, and we sit there and debate with him. But that's freedom. That's love. Okay, we can't have salvation without individual freedom. Whenever the affection for truth and the affection for good are being implanted by the Lord, which is done without our awareness of it, we take in truth and we do good in freedom because we are acting from our own affections. You know, it's in the Old Testament, the law was written on stone, but it's over there telling you what to do. And the Lord says, I have a better solution. I'm going to write it on your heart. It'll be in you. It will be you. You'll want to do it because it's not over there telling you do or don't do. It's in you saying do and don't do. Isn't that a wonderful thought? No more struggling to try and fulfill God's commandments because he's implanted them in you. But he does this without our awareness, and it's done in freedom and from our affection. So what he's saying is that I'm only going to get as much
as I'm hungry for. So just say after me, dear Lord, help me to be hungry for goodness and for truth. Amen. Because the more hungry I am, the more He can give me. It's got to be in freedom. Unless we have freedom in everything we think and do, will, the Lord could not possibly implant within anybody the freedom to think what is true and the will what is good. So even though God is good, and even though God is truth, and every angel and every resurrected saint is good and is true, and they're getting that all from the Lord, there's still this little transaction that's going on, this freedom, always this freedom of us wanting it. Isn't that beautiful? Yeah. And the thing about goodness and truth is the more you taste it, the more you want it anyway. Isn't it? The more you want that. Right. Okay, so one more quote. They're just such good quotes. I had to put them in. For if we were to be reformed, we must think what is true as if from ourselves and do what is good as if from ourselves. And when we do so as if from ourselves, we are in freedom. Otherwise, no reformation or regeneration would ever be possible. What an amazing God that we serve, isn't it? Okay. They that wait upon the Lord. Isaiah here. Now I want to talk for a moment about real spiritual independence. That when the Lord gets a hold of your life, when you surrender and let Him get a hold of your life, because you're willingly laying yourself down, He can rise you up. Or raise you up is probably a better English. Raise you up, isn't it? We all know about thermals here, don't we? It's laws of thermodynamics. What does heat do? What does it do? It rises, doesn't it? It rises. What does cold do? It sinks. But here's an amazing, magical thing that happens. Out there, right now, the sun's shining, the heat's rising, and there's colder air sinking. As this process goes on, something magical happens. It flips. It flips on its side, and we get what's called thermals. Yeah? Thermals. Beautiful. And that's what eagles ride on. They that wait upon the Lord shall mount up with wings as the eagles. What's scripture talking about there? It's talking about the fact that, you know, most birds and eagles too flap real hard to get up somewhere. But the eagle, it knows how to find these thermals. And it gets into these thermals and it begins to ride. It's just resting. And while it's resting, it's able to look and watch for a nice meal, for food. It's just rising. And when it spots something, it can slip out of the thermal with the flick of its tail or wing, slip out and begin to dive. And it does at will, it can flick back into that thermal and rise again. And this is exactly what surrendering to God is all about. When we give in and let Him take over, it's not about Him dominating us. It's the exact opposite. It's about Him empowering us and lifting us up into places where we could never get to on our own. Amen? That's it. The wings of an eagle. They that wait upon the Lord shall mount up with the wings of an eagle. Okay, let's move into the order of service. So, Chris, would you help me out there by reading the front of the order of service there? And Jane, would you help me with some quotes inside too?
Spiritual independence is the virtue of a well-formed assurance and internal trust in the Lord's plan for our lives. Within the new church, this virtue is best captured by the phrase quoted in our statement of faith. These things ought to be done by man as if of himself, but he should believe that they are from the Lord, acting with him and through him. This virtue gives us the courage and strength to step out of our metaphoric boat and attempt to walk on the water of life's challenges. Independence moves us forward into our true, authentic self, the individual that the Lord has intended us to become. We learn to make our own decisions outside of the push from the social collective. We break free from the sheeple mentality that herds the mind of the uninformed and unsuspecting. Fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. Independence allows the eagle to rise above the other flocks and gain a new perspective It enables the leader within to be born. True spiritual independence, of course, is not defined against good or true, but is born of genuine discipleship and respect for godliness.
Okay, so as we move into the order of service, I want you to keep in your mind Joseph. Beautiful example of this very thing. Here is Joseph, son of, he's one of 12. He's not the youngest. Benjamin's the youngest. I think he's the second youngest. Ian, is that?
Joseph.
Second, yeah. Joseph starts to sort of rise up and shine in this spirit of godly independence. He starts having dreams and visions, and it really irritates his brothers so much that they become murderous. They take his coat of many colors, and they rub lamb's blood on it. They throw him in a pit. They wait for some travelers to come by, and they sell him off to Egypt. Anyone here ever felt like you've been treated like that in life? I think if you've walked with the Lord a while, you'll have been treated like that somewhere, I promise you. It's true. So they then go to their father, Jacob, and say, "We're really sorry, but he's been killed," and show him the coat with the blood on it. Imagine how Jacob's heart would have been torn at that time. But here's the real mystery. What the devil meant for harm, the Lord is turning into good, isn't he? Joseph, being mistreated by his brother, is actually going to save them. Goes off to Egypt, becomes second to Pharaoh, uses his gift of dreams and visions to find out that a famine is coming, saves Egypt and all the lands around, saves his family. I mean, this is incredible. It's really the story of Jesus, isn't it? Isn't it? Think about it. But the point that I want to show you here is how often we can have this mentality as believers that I just need to be a good little sheep. Nothing wrong with being a good little sheep, but the Lord wants to raise you up into a shepherd. A shepherd. I'm playing with words there. He wants to bring the leader out. Les and Bev Shepherd. Nothing wrong with that. It's a good name to have. He wants to bring us out of, to find that leader within us and raise us up, because we are meant to be lights. Now, you can't have a sky full of lights. It would just be white. So I get the world's a dark place, but the Lord wants us to rise up and be lights. And we've got to learn to step out in this spirit, this virtue of independence. Not of God, but of the world. In John 16, the Lord says, "I don't pray for you to take them out of the world, but I pray that you keep them from the evil one." Amen? Yeah. So say after me, Lord, teach me to be a leader in what is good and true, and keep me from enslavement to evil. Amen. And that's what this virtue is really about. And the other example I've got here for you, that's later on, Joseph being trying to be seduced by Potiphar's wife, and of course he did the right thing, didn't he? He said no to her, and then she turned and claimed that he tore her dress and all that. But Helen Keller is another example. I'm always trying to find examples of this. Helen Keller, at a very young age, losing her eyesight, her hearing, and her ability to speak. Imagine your world turning dark, silent, and you can't even talk to people. How many of us would have been crushed by that? She turned it around. She turned it around and used this as a gift. She became a person of incredible influence and power because of what she'd overcome. And that's what we've got to do. It's such a challenge. When we've been given what we feel like is a bum deal, we've got to trust the Lord. There is something in this that he wants to rise us up out of and turn into greater good. Isn't it? And that's, we've got to hold on to that. Because the enemy wants us to just believe that God's not loving us, or we've failed, or we're not good enough. You can never be good enough. Never. But that's okay, because we need him to be our goodness anyway. Helen Keller. All right, so moving into the order of service. Here is our tame. Take a moment examining your life. I call that tame. Take a moment examining your life. Pause and reflect upon the virtue of independence. The goal of every healthy parent is to see their children grow up into healthy, independent adults. Consider an area in your life where you lag behind in independence. How did that impact your life and your outcomes? Can you think of something that you still need to give attention to today? Isn't it? We've all got some area in our life where maybe we've been dragging our feet a little bit. I'll get to that, Lord. And yet, really, the Lord wants us to stop being dependent upon something out there and rise up and become independent. Here's a dictionary definition. Freedom from the influence, control, or determination of another or others. Synonyms, I like synonyms because it opens things up. Ability, autonomy, self-determination, self-government, self-reliance, self-rule, self-sufficiency. Although in brackets I put God's sufficiency in there, in brackets. Self-sufficiency, just put a little pen there, God's sufficiency. But it's self-sufficient in the sense that I'm not relying on you all the time to be my strength, to keep picking me up. Separation. Sovereignty. What a beautiful word is that? Sovereignty. This is a dictionary. Aptitude, license, qualification. And I couldn't find many antonyms, only three. The opposite of independence was dependence. Well, that's pretty obvious. Inaptitude and subordination. Ooh, shut up. Inaptitude, the inability to act. It's a lack of power. Or subordination. Okay. So Jane, would you start reading through some of those quotes for us?
So Martin Luther King Jr., freedom is never voluntarily given by the oppressor. It must be demanded by the oppressed.
Wow, just let that sink in for a moment. Sin in your life and evil spirits are not going to just back off, ever. You've got to put some force and energy towards them with prayer.
Charlotte Bronte said, I am no bird and no net ensnares me. I am a free human being with an independent will.
I thought that was beautiful because she was writing in a time where it wasn't really very popular for women to be authors, was it? Remember this. Today's heroes were yesterday's rebels. Remember that. They mightn't have been very liked by the sheeple. Why are you causing us trouble all the time? Today's heroes were yesterday's rebels. Good point. Okay, so the next one.
Brigham Young. True independence and freedom can only exist in doing what's right.
That's beautiful, isn't it? Yeah, so it's up to us to do what's right. Do you want to read some of those scriptural quotes for us, Jane?
So John 3:8, the wind blows where it wills, and you hear the sound thereof, but cannot tell where it comes and where it goes. So is everyone that is born of the Spirit.
Beautiful.
2 Corinthians 3:17. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty.
Okay, I've used it so many times in my life. I'm going, why am I lacking a real freedom and liberty, Lord? It can only be because I don't have enough of your Spirit at work in my life. And okay, time to do some work. And so if you're in an area where you feel bound up, ask for more of the Lord. That's the solution.
Luke 7:26-28. But what went ye out for to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and much more than a prophet, this is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. For I say unto you, among those that are born of women, there is not a greater prophet than John the Baptist, but he that is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he.
You need me to talk about this for a moment, really, because that has to be a very difficult passage. Has anybody ever read that themselves and gone, what? What do you mean? John the Baptist is
ushering in Jesus Christ. So what's he talking about there? He's no idea. Can we sort of no idea. Ian, have you got any ideas? You got some thoughts rolling around what he's talking about? No, not now. Here's the best I can give you, right? Here's the best that I can give you. John the Baptist is operating in the office of a prophet, right? And in the Old Testament, the Lord would rest upon the prophet and they would prophesy. And then after the Spirit of the Lord lifted, they'd stop prophesying. They'd be operating like anyone else. And so there's this idea of, you know, the Shekinah glory of God coming down and resting on the person and then lifting off again, kind of like that. But anyone born of the Spirit, as we are in the new dispensation as Christians, we have the abiding presence of God in our life because of the work of Jesus. We have the abiding work of the Lord here, even when we sin. Even when we sin. Now, that's not permission to sin, but think about the benefit of even the least in the kingdom of heaven are having that abiding presence of God with you, where the prophets of the Old Testament would have the Lord descend for a time and go. I mean, that's why Elijah wandered off into the mountains and hid himself and felt sorry for himself for a long period of time until the Lord could visit him and sort of, you know, slap him very gently around the chops and say, "What are you doing here? I didn't send you here." We have something greater than what the prophets had. We have an abiding presence of God. And it's come in this freedom, this absolute freedom that the Lord is giving us. We have the ability to exercise real spiritual independence. And he lives in here. That's amazing, amazing passage. John 8:36.
If the Son therefore shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed.
Beautiful.
1 Corinthians 12:11. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will.
Right. And I put that in there because most of us here are still trying to figure out our gifts. I promise you, you still have gifts in your life that you have not yet activated and discovered. But the answer to it is the Spirit of God. The more you can surrender to the Lord and his Spirit, the more he doesn't take from you, the more he activates these gifts in you that are dormant. You know, Paul says it to Peter, to Timothy this way. He says, "Timothy, stir up the gift of God that is in you." And the picture I always get when I read that is a cup of tea. You've handed it to someone. They are, how many? One or two? Oh, two. And then they sip it. "Oh, you didn't put any sugar. Oh, here's the spoon. Stir it up. It's in there." They stir it up and then, there you go. That's what's in your life that's not being stirred up right now. And you need to surrender to the Lord to activate it. Not to lose, but to gain. Say after me, "Dear Lord, I trust you.
I trust you.
Take my hand.
Take my hand.
And lead me further down the path of surrender. That I may learn to fly." Amen. So, now I've got one more reading, and I've done a lot of readings today, and you guys have been very patient. I appreciate you letting me do all these readings with you. This reading is just one of my favorites. Because what I'm hoping to give you from this reading, it's on the back. What I'm hoping to leave you with today is a new determination to go to the Bible for yourself and dig out its treasures. There's nothing wrong with coming to church. I love it. I want people to come to church, and it gives me a gift to operate in, to open the Word. But each one of us needs to go to that Word and dig out its treasures. Here's what it says. "It is well known that a church is like its doctrine, and the Word is the source of doctrine. Yet, it is not doctrine which establishes a church, but the wholeness and the purity of its doctrine, and consequently, its understanding, or the church's understanding of the Word. But in the case of a particular church," now when he says particular church, he's talking about you and me. We are a church. We are the temple of God. So in the case of a particular church, which exists in the individual, It is not doctrine which establishes and makes that person a church. It is faith and a life lived in accordance with faith. Likewise, it is not the word which establishes and makes the particular church in the case of a person, but faith in accordance with the truths of the word. Right? So we've all heard in James where he says, it's not the hearer of the word that is righteous. Can you finish that one for me, Sean? It's not the hearer of the word that is righteous, but... Thank you. Sean's reading. It's the doer of the word that's righteous, isn't it? Okay, and Swinburne's making that case here. He's saying, likewise, it is not the word which establishes and makes the particular church in the case of a person, but it is faith in accordance with its truths, and the life in accordance with the kind of goods which that person is drawing from this source and applying to himself. The word is like a mine, the depths which are rich in gold and silver, or like a mine containing richer and richer veins of gems the further one goes into it. It is the understanding of the word which is opening up these mines. If it is not understood as it is in itself, in its innermost recesses and its depths, the word would no more bring about a church in a case of a person than the mines in Asia would make a European wealthy. It would be quite different if he were among the mine owners and operators. For those who probe the word to extract from it its truths of faith and the kind of goods which are needed for life, the word is like treasure owned by the Shah of Persia or the Mughal or Chinese emperors. People belonging to the church are like their treasurers. So, what we're being told here is that God has a mine full of gold, silver, and incredibly precious gems. Would anybody like some of them? Yes, amen. Not only can you have some, he is putting you in charge of it as his treasurer. Oh, you are God's treasurer. What a thought. He goes on to say here, where is it, treasurer? We are like their treasurers who have permission to take out as much as they want for their own purposes. On the other hand, those who merely possess the word and read it without seeking for genuine truths to establish faith and a genuine kind of good to guide life are like those who know from the newspapers that there are these vast treasures there, but they never get a penny from them. Those who possess the word without drawing from it any understanding of genuine truth or any will for genuine good are like those people who think themselves wealthy because they have taken huge loans from others or large proprietors on the strength of renting other people's estates, houses, and merchandise. Anyone can see that this is imaginary. They are also like people who walk about in magnificent costumes, ride in gilded carriages with outriders behind and on either side, and runners in the front. Yet they do not actually own any of these things. Kind of a last sentence sort of reminds me of, you know, Hollywood and actors who play the part of famous emperors or kings. And for a short moment, they're dressed up and they're playing the part. But then, cut, scene's over. They take all the costumes off and they're just normal actors again, isn't it? They're just normal red-blooded actors like everyone else. But for a moment, there was this illusion of being somebody. And this is what we're being warned about here. Going to church, having a Bible, even reading it at home, kind of like ritualistically, is a real danger that we're not drawing out those treasures. The Lord wants to give us a spirit of independence where we don't depend on anyone else, but we go to Him and we draw out those treasures from the Word. That's my challenge today. Anybody take that challenge? A couple of hands go up. That's good. Every hand goes up. Say after me, dear Lord, teach me how to dig out the treasures of your Word and apply them to my life, that I may be rich and abundant in spiritual life, in joy, in peace, in blessings. Amen. Okay, so this month, on the bottom, there's your challenge. This month, challenge yourself to get to the bottom of a mysterious passage from sacred text. There you go.
Jump online, use a search engine to reach or reach out to a friend for help if necessary. So something's going to come up for you, I promise. You'll hear a passage, you'll see it, and you'll go, oh, what's that saying? Your challenge, Mission Impossible, is to let the Lord get you to the bottom of what that passage is saying. Amen? And you can ring a friend, call a friend for help. That's not cheating, because it's you putting the impetus in and the energy in to get to the bottom of what's going on here. Does that? You've got to activate that gift in you. Amen. So open up into the middle of the order of service and read with me the meditation, and we'll close in prayer, okay? Everybody saying with me, I am careful to listen to the thoughts and ideas of others. I allow myself to make my own conclusions. I trust in the Lord's guidance to reveal truth to me. I act and make decisions even if others may disagree. I am thankful, Lord, for the gift of independence. It challenges my life to grow and reach new heights of achievement in what is good, wholesome, and truthful. Amen. So you did really well, folks. Don't forget to take home your... Now let's read it. Don't forget to take home your card. Let's read this, the card. John 17:14-15, I have given them thy word, and the world has hated them, because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. And I pray not that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil. And down here in the book Divine Providence, where Swedenborg explains how divine providence works, this is what he says. It says, the more closely we are united to the Lord, the more clearly we seem to have our own identity. And yet, the more obvious it is to us that we belong to the Lord. Since people who are united to the Lord are neither willing nor able to think and intend what is evil, the outward appearance of uniting to the Lord leads others to believe that this amounts to a loss of identity. Yet, it is the exact opposite. Isn't that an amazing thought? You know, people look at us and say, oh, you're following religion and, you know, stealing all the fun things in life. I don't want those, you're gonna have those.
I get, oh, so you use this church thing as a crutch. Yeah, I do. I do. Why would I want to limp when I've got help?
You know? I love it. Amen. Well, let's just close in prayer, and then I'll put on a new commandment as I close the word. Dear Lord, we are so grateful for your word. It's rich with wisdom and light and treasures that we cannot yet search. But I trust, Lord, the more we walk with you and the more we surrender, the more you will safely open up its treasures, that we may draw from it so that our life can be blessed, that our life can have an abundance of good things, your goodness, your love, and your life. Amen.
One for another.
bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you, the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his everlasting peace. So we'll go downstairs for a cup of coffee or tea. Hopefully you've all been inspired to dig into the Word a little deeper this month and to remember that the Lord wants you to be someone unique and special, and that surrender is actually about discovering that person he wants you to be.
Amen.
Yeah.
So being